1971 to 1974. Strat-O-Matic Excel Carryover League. Brought to you by the Shrimp Trawler.
Game 73, Indians at White Sox.
Welcome back, baseball fans, the 1971-74 Carryover League. We got a series in the American League today between the Cleveland Indians and the Chicago White Sox. And these two teams have become players in this timeline. White Sox traditionally would have been behind the Oakland A's out west, but they're not in the west. They're in their own division in the Midwest. Cleveland, they would have been behind Baltimore, Boston, Detroit, the Yankees, and American League East. They're not in the American League East. They're in the American League North. That's what divisional readjustment has done. You know, you have four divisions instead of two. We can just briefly look at the overall standings in there. And Cleveland and the White Sox in their own divisions now. At the top, everything's kind of jumbled up presently. But anyway, we got a nice series today. We played game one. Got to tell you what happened in game one, folks, opening up in Comiskey Park. So, game one starters, Cleveland puts Gaylord Perry out there against Tom Bradley. Low-scoring affair early. Two-run homer, Bill Melton's 2-zip. Tom Bradley is cruising along. Sixth inning, a sac fly by George Orta, 3-0. And Tom Bradley continues to cruise. He's cruising. Gaylord Perry takes the day off after seven innings with the writing on the wall. They're down 3-0. Here goes seven innings, five hits, three runs. We got a 3-0 game in the ninth. It's all about putting the dots and the crossing the T's on this one. But the Cleveland Indians in the top of the ninth inning with Tom Bradley trying to go for a complete game shutout. You get a gamble walk, a Duke Sims single, a Ray Fosse single, and yeah, Tom Bradley's out of there. So Terry Forster, the new White Sox closer, comes in and is asked to preserve a 3-0 save with the bases loaded and nobody out. He's greeted by pinch hitter Alex Johnson with an RBI single, pinch hitter Ron Swoboda with an RBI single, Mark Belanger, a bases-loaded walk to tie the game, and pinch hitter Eddie Leon, an RBI single to blow the game, or the lead, I should say, for the White Sox. It's now 4-3 Indians, a fly out, a sac fly, and a ground out. It's 5-3 Indians with a new life in the bottom of the ninth inning. Hilgendorf goes out there in the bottom of the ninth. He gets the first batter out, Tom Egan. Then the lefty faces the lefty Tony Muser, and Muser gets on with a single. So they go to the righty Vicente Romo against Aparicio, and they get him out. Both benches are exhausted, by the way, at this point. There's no more pinch hitters. One of the issues of a 20-man roster, you only have three moves you can make with your bench. Aparicio gets out, and then Walt Williams hits a ground ball to Buddy Bell, but he can't field it. It's a base hit off of Buddy Bell's defense. So two are on with two outs. And Stephen Gorey is brought in to face Buddy Bradford because Buddy Bradford can't hit lefties at all. He's got, on against righties, homers on 1-5 and 1-6 and hits into the two column. He only has a homer on 1-5 against lefties. And that is what Buddy Bradford did in the bottom of the ninth with two outs. He rolls a 1-5 homer, 1-17. It was an 8 on the dice roll. And that was a walk-off three-run homer by Buddy Bradford as both closers, Steve McGorry and Terry Forster, had better days. Well, McGorry just faced the one batter, gets the loss for the walk-off solo shot here. And Forster's line, in his one inning of relief work, gave up three hits, a walk, and two runs. But gets the win because of the walk-off. 6-5 White Sox beat the Indians in game one. Wow. Fun game one. we'll go to game two today, and get, so you can see some different pitchers than you saw on opening day, is what the pattern will be as we move along in the schedule, try and mix it up a little bit. So we have a game two game here. It is going to be Jim Perry for the Indians, a 17-game winner in 74 with a 2.96 ERA and 252 Indians innings for the Indians. Stan Bonson will take the mound for the Chi Sox. Had a very nice year in 72. Won 21 games for the White Sox with 3.61 ERA and 252 innings. Let's get started from wild and crazy Comiskey Park. No 3-0 lead is safe in the ninth inning, folks. We've just proven that. And leading off for Cleveland will be John Lowenstein, 56K. It's too early in the season for 10-cent beer night, I believe. Or disco demolition or anything like that. I think the guys are going to play this pretty straight up and normal here. Buddy Bill, 34 pops are short. Chris Chambliss, 1-8 is a single. And Duke Sims, 58, flying to right field. Bottom of the first, it'll be Ken Henderson. 35 is a walk. Buddy Bradford, let's take a look at his card. And this is what you saw. He crushes righties there. And so they took the righty out and they went to Mingori, as he doesn't do much at all against lefties, except for the 1-5. And then even after rolling it, you got to hope you don't roll an 18, 19, or 20, just to really, yeah. So yeah, Buddy Bradford, in his first time, last at bat, he gets a nice little ovation as he comes to the batter's box here. 6'11", off of the Perry card is pitcher X. Jim Perry's an E11, and he makes the play, and it's a 1-6-3 double play. On a GBA there. Tough break for the Chi Sox. So after the double play, it's Carlos May, 46, pops to second base. Top of two, Ray Fosse, 59, skies it in the center. Oscar Gamble, 57, is a base hit. Veda Pinson, 27, is a single to left field. Gamble has wheels and May does not have an arm in the outfield, so he's going to try and go coast to coast, and he makes it. The runners are in the corners. The infield's going to come up against Mark Belanger. 1-8 is a strikeout. And with two outs, it's Jack Deadblowhammer, 57. That's another base hit off this Dan Bonson card with runners in the corners and two outs. That'll play to run. It is to right field where we have Bradford, the minus two arm, Veda Pinson. Will not make the third out of third. So you'll have first and second with two outs and a run scored. It'll be John Lowenstein. 1-9, let's take a look at John Lowenstein's card. His best early year in his career, 292 year with the Indians in 73. Then he kind of floundered around in the mid-70s with the Indians and Tigers before he caught life with the Baltimore in 79, 80, 81, 82 era. But here, 1-9 with Lowenstein, triple, one, double. Will score one run. Brohammer, can he score from first on a double? 13, 14, 15. Center fielder's got a minus two arm, 13. Can't run on a 13. He'll be stuck at third with two outs for Buddy Bell. 56 off of Bonson is a pop to short, but the Indians grab an early 2-0 lead. Dick Allen, 53, flies to right X. This is Oscar Gamble, a 4E8 in right field. That's going to be a single. George batting out of Orta, 2-4, flies to right. Bill Meltwan, 1-8. 1-8 for Melton. This is a short plus single because you had to hold Dick Allen on base so you get that plus single. And you have runners on the corners for Bob Stinson. 59 left, but it's too shallow. So it's fly ball C. And with two outs, it's Tony Muser. Same roll, 59, fly ball FC. All right, we go to the third inning. Chris Chambliss, 47, single 1-3, is a base hit on the three. Duke Sims, 3-6 is a walk. Two on for Ray Fosse, 59, center. Oscar Gamble, 6-11, second X. Second baseman is Horta, 4-E-20. I'll take the ground ball B. Fielder's choice, the runners are on the corners with two outs for Veda Pinson, who singled and scored earlier. 4-10 off of Bonson, short X. They didn't start Aparicio today. They have Bucky Dent, a 3-30 at short, but he makes the play. Gambled with the defense, it didn't hurt. Stays 2-0, bottom of the third. Here is Bucky Dent playing today, giving Aparicio a day off against a right-hander. 2-3, grounds the third. Ken Henderson, 2-7, single 1-10, is a base hit for the B-Stealer. Fossey's got a minus 3 arm, he's not going to go anywhere. Buddy Bradford, 1-7, you saw the card, it's homer 1 fly ball, and that's a fly ball. And with two outs, it's Carlos May. 1-10, flies to right field. We go to the fourth, it's Mark Belanger. 1-7, grounds are short. Jack Brohammer, 67, is a K, and with two outs. John Lowenstein, 58, flies to right field. Bottom of the fourth, moving right along here. Dick Allen, 2-6, is a base hit for the B-Stealer. George Orta, 2-9, is another base hit through the hole at second base. So they have been too distracted with Dick Allen and his speed at first base, even though he doesn't steal much. He's just a B-Stealer, but it's hit through the wickets, and you got runners on the corners with nobody out in a 2-0 game, and it's Bill Melton. Orta's a C-Stealer. He won't be given much attention there. The pitch to Bill Melton, 32. Fly ball to left field A. So it's a sac fly, and it's so deep that Orta tags and goes to second. 2-1 game, tying run at second. One out. The batter's Bob Stinson. 68 off of Jim Perry's card is single 1-10. Gets it on a 3. Runners on the corners. One out. They're going to bring the infield up trying to protect the lead for Tony Muser. 56 is short X. This is Belanger. This will definitely probably, yeah. Runner holds at third. Runner first goes to second. So you have second and third with two outs. And Bucky Dent. 45 flies to left field. Well, Chi Sox cut the lead in half as we go to the fifth. It's Buddy Bell. 1-5, let's take a look at Buddy Bell's card of 1972 with the Indians. 255 batting average and 500 plate appearances. Could play right field and third base. So his defense is mediocre presently. Gave up that big hit in game one in the ninth inning off his defense. But here, 1-5 is homer, 1-8 double. And he rolls a 20 here. That'll be a two-base hit. Chris Chambliss, 6-12 off Bonson's a walk. Not a great day for Stan. 2 on for Duke Sims. 59 flies to center. Ray Fossey, 37 is a K. And with 2 outs, it's Oscar Gamble. 68 off of Bonson. That's going to score a run or two. Double 1-9, single dot dot. That's going to be a single dot dot. That will score Buddy Bell. Chambliss moves to third. 3-1 with 2 outs. Runners on the corners. Veda Pinson, 1-8, rolls to first base. 3-1 lead for the Indians as we go to the bottom of fifth. Let's pause a moment for station identification.
This is the Shrimp Trawler video channel.
Este es el canal de videos de camaroneros.
Okay, bottom of the fifth we go. Down a couple runs, Ken Henderson. 4-4 off Perry, center X. This is Pinson, a 3-2 in center field. And it's going to be a double off his 3 range. And the Chi Sox will bring the tie run to the plate. Buddy Bradford, 37's a K. Carlos May, 57, second X. Brohammer, 4-27. Not there with the glove or the bat yet, but yeah. And that's going to be a single off of his range, and it's a dot-dot single, scoring Ken Henderson, bringing the White Sox within a run. Dick Allen, runner at first. This is Carlos May, a stealer. They're threatening to steal, but they're not going to go anywhere. I don't know why the Indians are so worried about it. Fossey's got a minus 3 arm, but Dick Allen is the batter. 3-6 is a walk. Now you have two on with one out, and the stolen base is somewhat taken away at this point. Batting out of order, 5-10, catcher's card. Fosse again, a 1E11, high E rating, but you get the foul out there, so the runners don't move. Bill Melton, two on and two outs. The pitch to Bill Melton, 64. Off Perry's card, it is homer 1-4, fly ball the rest, and he just misses it with a roll of a 6. The wind caught a hold of that one, kept it in the park. Tough break for Bill Melton there. And it stays 3-2. These two teams play some fun baseball. Let's go to the sixth. Mark Belanger. 49 is a walk off Stan Bonson's card, who's a starter 6. Now, how many guys has this guy put on today? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We'll see what Brohammer does. Brohammer, I think he's going to take advantage of the hit and run ability he possesses. Yeah, with Belanger, B Steeler. Belanger's a C Steeler, but he's going to hit and run anyway. Rolls an 8, moves Belanger up to second base for the top of the lineup and John Lowenstein. 1-7 for Lowenstein is a single to center field. Is a Belanger try and score with just one out? It's a 16 runner. Henderson's got a minus 2 arm. He has to run on a 14. It's one of the rules, 14 or better, and it's better. 14, and he runs and scores on a 14, exactly a 14. It was a close play. But this particular example, the gamble paid off for the inexperienced road third base coach, as I like to say, was you have to run on a 14. Home team, I can decide what I want to do, but I have a constant decision on for the road team, and it paid off for Cleveland in this instance. Let me just double check the numbers though. 16 for Belanger, yeah, 16, and minus 2 for Henderson does make it exactly 14, one out. Okay, that is an RBI single there, and it's a 4-2 game. Buddy Bell, 67 is a K, and with two outs is Chris Chambliss, and I'm going to pull the plug now on Bonson after 5 2/3, because it's a two-run game. Don't want it to get any worse, and Chambliss is much better against righties and lefties. So we're going to bring Dave Lemons out of the White Sox bullpen, 1972, 4-7, the 2.94 ERA in 95 innings. Dave Lemons comes on in the sixth to face Chris Chambliss. Runner at first, two outs. The pitch to Chris Chambliss. 3-10 is a strikeout. All right, Jim Perry sailing along. A starter 7, 4-2 game, and you know what? The Indians are even going to bring in a better defensive second baseman for Jack Blowhammer. They're going to bring in Eddie Leon. Yeah. That's what they will do. Okay, bottom of the sixth. Bob Stinson leads off for the White Sox. 6-10, third X. This is Buddy Bell, 3-13. That is a single off of his range again, just like in the ninth inning of game one, which preceded a game-winning home run. And this time it's Tony Muser, down a couple, runner at first, pitch Tony Muser. 2-4, third B, fielder's choice. So he legs out and avoids a double play there. So the runner at first again, and it's Bucky Dent. 2-7 for Bucky Dent. Let's take a look at Bucky's card, because he can't hit a ball very far, but when he does get a hold of one, it's a nice little single dot on the roll of 2-7. 248 year and 117. All he has to do is back up George Orta defensively and give Louis Aparicio a break now and then. So we put him in the league here with this card, and it's a single dot. We got runners in the corners in a 4-2 game, and Jim Perry is stumbling here as we go back up top to the lineup here. Ken Henderson has not gotten out. He is a walk, a single, and a double. And the pitch to Ken Henderson. 1-8 is a K. Two outs now, and it's the dangerous Buddy Bradford. 47 off of Perry. He pops to short. Jim Perry stiffens up at the bottom of the sixth inning, getting the top of the lineup out as we go to the seventh. 4-2 game. Another exciting game between these two squads. Neither team giving in. Duke Sims will exit. Batting for Duke Sims will be Ron, I'm going to get you on a Swoboda China. He'll come in, pinch hitting for Sims, move into the outfield, and take over Gamble Will at DH. So Swoboda will bat. 63, second X. This is Orta at second. Yes, he's a 4E20 at second base. But he makes the ground ball C. A little home cooking defensively there. On the road, that's probably an error. Ray Fossey. 38, flies to center. And with two outs, it's Oscar Gamble. Pretty symmetrical player. Could hit lefties and righties. 6'11", pitcher X, Lemons. And he's zero pitcher. We don't roll for those for the home team. Nice game. Stretch time here in Chicago. We are enjoying Baby Huey. The Baby Huey story. This is a reissue, but I think it's 1970. He put out this record with Listen to Me, Mighty Mighty, Hard Times, You Got Me Running, backed up by Curtis Mayfield's brilliant band. Tragic story. Left our dimension way too young. Baby Huey and the Babysitters. All right. Great extended compilation with a bunch of instrumentals with that great Superfly band of the 70s. So, yeah. All right. Bottom of the seventh. Jim Perry. I'm going to play this as if he cannot lose this game. Puts two batters on, he's hooked. So we'll go Carlos May leading off in the bottom of the seventh. 58. Flies right. Dig Allen. He is two singles and a walk. 110. There's another single. 3-for-3 plus a walk for your MVP. My goodness. George Orta. This might be a good time to get Perry out of here with the two lefties you have in the bullpen. Because Orta kills righties. And let's do that. Let's hook, kind of a quick hook on Jim Perry. 6 1/3. But the tying run is at the plate. And Orta, you can make it much worse against lefties. Tom Hilgendorf will come in. The wheels are spinning in the managerial dugout here because they do have Walt Williams on the bench. You could pinch hit him, and then you would need Dent as a second baseman. Then you just have to put Aparicio in for one of your extra outfielders. So do you want to use... Yes, they're going to do it. They're going to go right to Walt Williams here as the pinch hitter, get his bat in the lineup. Let's take a look at Walt Williams. 71 Walt Williams at 294 for the Chi Sox, 8 home runs, and he's sort of the odd man out of the bullpen. Odd man out of the outfield, I should say, as left field is Carlos May, center Ken Anderson, newly acquired, and Buddy Bradford's been in right. So Williams has had to pick his spots at DH, platoon outfielder, and he could even fill in a third base for Bill Melton in an emergency. So big moment here when he comes in. So Hilgendorf, let me give you Hilgendorf's line as well. 5-2 with a 3.14 ERA for the 73 Indians. Hilgendorf comes on in the seventh to face Walt Williams with Dick Allen at first and one out. The pitch to Walt Williams. 37 is a base hit again because you're holding the runner on and you roll the plus. Only the third time this has happened in one game, which is remarkable. I mean, I'm lucky if I get one of these a game, if ever. But it's happened three times, all for the White Sox, and it all because Dick Allen is a B-stealer. Melton got one on his card. Orta got one on his card. Williams got one on his card. So it's a lot of luck here for the Chi Sox with runners on the corners, and it's Bill Melton. Williams is not to be held on. They're going to play back, hope for double play, and pitch to Bill Melton. 56 is second X. We did bring our defense in. Yeah, we did bring in Leon. Leon's a 2E16 at second base. And that is a GBA on Eddie Leon's 2E16 defense we brought in at the end of the inning when Jack Bromer got his final at-bat. And that is the counter punch. What a slugfest. Each team's moves are helping and hurting at the same time. But that is a 4-6-3 double play for Bill Melton after the White Sox seemingly got a huge break on the single that took move Bill... Dick Allen over to third. 4-2 game. We go to the eighth inning. Dave Lemons has done a great job in an inning and a third. He'll face one more batter, Vita Pinson. And then we'll go to a righty. 45 flies to center field. So, an inning and two thirds for Dave Lemons. We're going to go to Jack Aker in the eighth. Acquired in the offseason to help at the back end. Was going to be the closer, but then they improved Terry Forster, made him the closer. Really, they have two closers, Aker and Forster. Situationally, Aker comes in here now. He was a Yankee in 71 with a 2.57 ERA in 56 innings. So Jack Aker will face Belanger. 110 is a fly to left, and with two outs, it's Eddie Leon. 2-4 grounds to third base. All right, bottom of the eighth inning. Hilgendorf will pitch through to Muser to turn him around. Well, I don't think they do turn Muser around. I let him hit against lefties. All right, batting for Bob Stinson will be Tom Egan. There's a bunch of homers on this card. Pitch to Tom Egan. 2-7 is a K. Tony Muser. Dick Allen could play first base, but you only have Aparicio on your bench. Yeah, let's put Aparicio in there. Aparicio will bat for Muser since Dick Allen can play move to first base. Aparicio will be at short. Dent is at second. Well, Williams is at DH because we pulled Orta out of the game, so... They're also going to hook Hilgendorf. So Hilgendorf will leave after an inning as the wheels are spinning for both managers trying to... Look, Cleveland and the White Sox, this is serious business for these two teams. They're not just also-rans. They're trying to win the whole darn enchilada. So Vicente Roma will come on in the eighth inning as a righty to face Aparicio and Dent here in the eighth inning. Down two. Louis Aparicio, 5-12, rolls to the pitcher. And with two outs, it's Bucky Dent, who singled his previous at-bat. 2-10 is a walk, and that does bring the tie run up to Ken Henderson. Let's take a look at the Ken Henderson card as the tie run in the bottom of the eighth. Wonderful year, 20 home runs in 74 for the White Sox, a .292 average. You might as well... They're gonna do it. They're gonna do another quick hook here. They're gonna Mingori, and ask Mingori, who blew the save in game one, to get. Actually, Vicente Roma did get one batter out, to get a four-out save. So let's bring in Mingori to show you him. He was 1-2 with a 1.42 ERA in 57 innings for the Indians in 71. Mingori comes on in the eighth inning to face Ken Henderson. As the tie run, the runner at first and two outs. And here is the pitch to Ken Henderson. 56 is a fly ball to left. We go to the ninth. Thrills a minute in this game. Long game for just a 4-2 affair. John Lowenstein leads off the ninth. 5-10 catcher's card. The new catcher, Egan, is a 2E16. And he makes the play. Buddy Bell, 65, flies to right. And Chris Chambliss, 5'10", catcher's card. Again, Egan, 2E16, makes the play. Bottom of the ninth for Steve Mingori. He's got Buddy Bradford, the hero of game one, who I showed you earlier is not that good against lefties, plus a solo homer won't even tie this thing. Carlos May, a left-handed bat. Then after that, it gets kind of scary because you got Allen, Williams, Melton, and you only have Ray Lamb in the bullpen. So here we go with Buddy Bradford leading off the bottom of the ninth. 6-10, third X. This is Buddy Bell, a 3-13 at third base, has had his struggles, and another hit! He has had his struggles at third base. He's a good defensive player, a 3-13, but that's three singles in two games. Tough break there. Bradford is on, and now you've got some guys who are going to be some amazing tie runs here. Carlos May, let's take a look at some cards. Carlos May, your tie run, 72-308 hitter with 12 home runs, 79 walks, set the table for Dick Allen. And here's the pitch to Carlos May. 39 is a ball four, and here we go, folks. First two batters reach, and Mingori, oh, forgot to tell you that. He's a relief too, folks. He could be broken right here and now. And they only have Ray Lamb left. This seemingly deep bullpen isn't that deep if you keep making situational changes, which is what the Indians have done to this point. You got two on with a two-run lead. Dick Allen, let's take a look at Dick Allen's card. The MVP of 1972 had 37 home runs, 99 walks, a 308 batting average. He and Carlos May both hit 308, and Allen won that by the narrowest of percentage points as far as the team league lead in batting average. Crushes lefties. They're going to play back and hope for a double play. You know, Mingori's an outstanding pitcher if you can just roll in his car for once, but here we go. Dick Allen with two on and nobody out. 2-6 for Allen is going to be. It's a single chance. It's single 1-3. Line out the short, and he rolls a one and gets the single. Remarkable. Now you got the bases loaded. You got nobody out. You've broken Steve Mingori. Vincente Romo and Tom Hilgendorf are out of the game. You got a two-run lead, but you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five straight right-handed batters against the lefty Mingori. I think they're pulling him. I think this is a failure, and they're saying, you know what, it's just not your day there, bud. And that's it. Mingori's going to leave. Loading the bases in the ninth inning and asking Ray Lamb to come in and try and get a save. Ray Lamb is a decent long relief man. Put in an unusual situation here. In 71, Ray Lamb was 6-12 with a 3.36 ERA in 158 innings. He's generally a starter. But he became the long man when they had all the depth in the rotation with Perry, the Perry brothers, and Dick Tidrow as the righties. So Ray Lamb is being called in. He can give up a run, or even two to make it a tie. But they're asking him to come on in the ninth inning with the bases loaded and nobody out. Oh, by the way, face the 294 hitting Walt Williams, the 33 homers of Bill Melton, and Tom Egan here in the ninth. So it'll be Walt Williams with the bases loaded, nobody out, down two. Here's the pitch to Walt Williams. 1-12, misses the column. It's ground ball. He's an A bunter. So ground ball short, B brought the infield up and a fielder's choice at the plate. So that doesn't do a whole lot. It just rotates all the runners. Now you got May at third, Allen at second, and Walt Williams is at first. With a force out at the plate. Melton, they're going to play back. He's a D-bunter. The pitch to Bill Melton. 1-6 is fly ball center B question mark. They're not going to run this guy. No point in trying to tag up here, as it's a two-run game. So they're going to forego the RBI shot off of Ada Pinson. And now, with two outs, it's up to Tom Egan. Again, nobody left on the bench for this team. Tom Egan. Let's take a look at Tom's car, because he's got plenty of power. With the White Sox in 71, he had 10 homers and 251 at-bats. That's a lot of power for a catcher in this era. And it's pretty symmetrical both ways, as you can see, with enough walks to make him an interesting player. So here he is in his hero moment. Ladies and gentlemen, Tom Egan with the bases loaded and two outs in the bottom of the ninth. Here is the pitch. 2-12, you rolled the column at the wrong end of it. And 2-12, well, it's a low max. So it's just a line out to third base. And it is the Ray Lamb story today. He comes on in the ninth inning. The Cleveland long man comes on in the ninth inning with the bases loaded and nobody out. Oh, I'll just get all these guys out. Oh, I don't really care. I got fielder's choice by Walt Williams, a lazy fly ball by Bill Melton, and a pop out to third by Tom Egan. And there it is, your 4-2 final in game two, and the Indians have tied this series a game apiece. Wow. So we'll do the box here. Wow, what a game. Both these teams have been scratching and clawing this year in their battles against the Indians beat up on the Oakland A's, and the White Sox beat the Red Sox. So they've had a tough schedule. You got the first place schedule from a year ago. So let's do the box here. Jack Aker got 5 outs. Dave Lemon, he got 5 outs with a strikeout. Great relief pitching for the White Sox. It's Stan Bonson had a troubled start, giving up 9 hits in the 4 runs. Could have been worse. So it's good on Stan that he put a lot of guys on base, but only 4 of them scored. 3 walks and 5 strikeouts. He does take the loss, as the Indians never lost the lead. Ray Lamb, we'll start back there. He gets the save in the ninth. 3 straight outs. Mingori got the final out in the 8th. Getting Ken Henderson out. Then he survived not getting a loss by giving up 2 hits on a walk and a 9th. Vicente Romo came on and gave up a walk to Bucky Dent. And getting Aparicio out. Hilgendorf give up a hit, a strikeout, and a double play. And Jim Perry does enough to get that win. The White Sox kill themselves with runners left on base. We talked about those pluses happening, but when you look at it, they didn't make anything out of it. Dick Allen went from first to third on that single, didn't score. He scored on a sac fly there, and he didn't score in the 7th inning, going from first and third on the single. So 11 hits allowed by Jim Perry, only 2 runs, 2 walks, and 2 strikeouts. 1019-0109-4924. 4924-3643-4336. So the Indians put 12 men on base. White Sox put 18 men on base today and only scored 2. So it is on them. They had 2 men on in the 7th, a guy on in the 8th, and of course the bases loaded in the 9th. Too many blown opportunities for the White Sox. They cannot win both of these games at home. That is game number 2. We'll look at the year-to-date standings and stats for these two teams. It's very early, of course, but it's always kind of fun to look at that. We expect the White Sox to be a little bit better off than the Indians. Roster construction-wise, it looks like the White Sox are better. They have a tremendous number of sticks on their team. The Indians have some nice bats, but they kind of struggle on the bench and at the bottom half of that lineup. White Sox just 3-4 to start the season. They're hitting .289 with a .390 ERA. And Wilbur Wood is 0-2. So he lost 2 games to the Red Sox in the opening series. Games 1 and 5 of that. And he'll be pitching tomorrow. So he's got to right that ship a little bit, and I think the White Sox will be fine once Wilbur Wood gets on track. As far as the Indians go, the Indians are 4-2, hitting .319 with a .222 ERA. So they are clearly performing outstanding here. Jim Perry's 2-0. Mingori has a loss and no saves. Ray Lamb has the only save for the Indians. Chris Chambliss is 11 for 24 to start the season for the Indians. All right, that's it for that game. We'll give you the results of the series as it shifts to Cleveland for games 3 and 4 if necessary. Thanks for checking this out, and we'll see you at the end of the video. All right, folks, we'll show you what's gone on in the rest of this series. This is the box score in game one again, where the White Sox got the walk-off homer by Buddy Bradford, got that first win. And then in game number two of the series, the game you just saw, the Indians even things up with a 4-2 road win in which Ray Lamb got the final three outs of the ninth inning to preserve a 4-2 victory. So the Indians even the series game apiece. So what's going to happen when we go to Municipal Stadium in Cleveland for games three and four? Well, a whole lot of pitching. Game number three, at least on one side of the ledger, game number three, it's Bart Johnson for the White Sox, a young promising pitcher against Mike Kilkenny, a lefty who's not particularly good, one of the weaker left-handed pitchers in the whole Strat League. Immediately, the White Sox get to him in the first, a single, a walk, a two-run single by Dick Allen. But then, three straight outs, and the White Sox just have a couple runs. Top of the second, a single, a triple by Ken Henderson. It's 3-0, and you're thinking, oh, here come the White Sox. Bottom of the fourth, RBI double by Jack Deadblow Hammer, and it's 3-1. But in the sixth inning, Bart Johnson can't get through it. And this is where problems start for the White Sox. A single, a walk. They bring Dave Lemons in, the lefty. He faces Swoboda, gives up a sack fly. Then there's an error by Bill Melton, and then a double by Chris Chambliss. It's a four-run inning. They take a 5-3 lead, do the Indians. It gets worse in the eighth. Dave Lemons and Lou Krause, the long man. Tough break here. A hit, a walk, two outs. And then it is Jack Brohammer, who has power for left-handed hitting second baseman, gets the homer off the Dave Lemons card. And that turns a 5-3 game into an 8-3 game. And the final is 9-4. And it seems like the Indians are living a charmed life. Aside from the game one walk-off, they've won two in a row here against a very good White Sox team. So what happens in game four? Can the Chicago White Sox even this thing up and send it back to Comiskey Park? And the answer is, no, they can't. And they got their guy, Wilbur Wood, on the mound against Dick Tidrow, folks. And in this game, there will be no pitching changes. It is Wilbur Wood and Dick Tidrow, who's actually the number four starter. Dick Tidrow is a very good pitcher, by the way. But they have Gaylord Perry and Jim Perry, two righties, at 1-2. So Tidrow has to move to 4. Bottom of the third inning, a couple singles, a double play. Then with two outs, Mark Belanger gets a bloop single. It's one zip, pretty innocent game. Stays that way through 8 innings. Bottom of the eighth, a leadoff double by Veda Pinson. Then you get an RBI single by Eddie Leone and a pinch single by John Lowenstein, which would have been, this is homer 1-2, fly ball the rest off of the Wilbur Wood card. He hits it, however, he doesn't have power against lefties, says Lowenstein. Gamble, that would have been a home run if they would have left Gamble in. This would have been a 5-0 game. Stayed just 3-0. But the story of the whole season and the series for the White Sox is, where are the bats? And Dick Tidrow in the ninth inning gets Orta and Allen and Carlos May, the meat of the lineup, three outs. It's over. Dick Tidrow, complete game shutout. 9 inning, 3 hits, 3 walks, 4 strikeouts. Wilbur Wood suffers his third straight defeat to start 2023. 8 innings, 8 hits, 3 runs, a walk and 5 strikeouts. Probably good enough to win most of the time, but the Indians are living a charmed life here, and the White Sox are clearly struggling. When we look at the overall stats of the two squads, you'll see it. Let's start with Cleveland. Winning the series 3-1, they are hitting .311 with a .217 ERA. Steve McGorry, their closer, has only pitched a third of an inning this year. They haven't needed him because they're winning without needing to get the saves. Great starting pitching and good hitting. 6-2 record. And the White Sox, they're just stumbling getting out of the gate. They're sleepwalking through this. They're 3-6. But the good news is they have the division schedule coming up. So they'll be playing the Brewers, they'll be playing the Royals, and the Twins. And they feel they can beat up on their own division. And that's what they're going to have to do to get back to the top. Because the White Sox have got a .269 batting average, which is respectable, but we expect big things out of this offense. A 4.26 ERA, which is a little disappointing. Wilbur Wood is 0-3. In 23 innings, he's given up 9 earned runs, 9 walks, 18 strikeouts. Very ordinary, and he has to be better than that. Offensively, the best... Ken Henderson is doing well leading off, 11 for 35. Not a lot of homers yet, only 2 for Melton that lead the club. And through 9 games, you know, it's very, very early. So no reason to be alarmed. But the White Sox do stumble out of the gate, and the Indians look like they're legit, folks. They look legit. Congratulations to Cleveland Indians, their second 3-1 interleague game series victory for the Cleveland Indians. Thanks for checking this out. We'll see you next time.